Hello everyone. Today we are going to talk about one of the most important movements in the 20th century literary criticism, which actually brought about a complete transformation in literary studies, especially a shift from criticism onto theory. And this theory could be taken as a kind of a foundation on which all the other theories are built up. The theory that we are going to talk about is New Criticism. New Criticism is a movement which had grown simultaneously on both sides of the Atlantic, that is England and the United States. So to be more precise, we can call it Anglo-American New Criticism instead of New Criticism. So to talk about that, I. Richards, in his Principles of Literary Criticism, gives the title of the first chapter of the Principles of Literary Criticism is The Chaos of Critical Theories. Of course, it was a chaotic moment. There was a total chaos in the critical studies, in the critical theories, in the literary situation as such. And critics were quite confused as to what should be considered important while analyzing literary works, in the sense whether they should go for the biographical details so as to get an understanding of the text, or to go for the historical background where they could place the text as such. Now, this was of course a chaotic moment in that sense, and it was to this critical juncture that critics like T.S. Eliot, I. Richards, William Empson, F.R. Lewis, etc. entered. Now let me give you some factual details on New Criticism. The term New Criticism was coined by Joel Spingarn, who is a historian of Renaissance criticism, who explained the theories of the Italian critic Croce in a booklet titled The New Criticism, which was published in the year 1911. But the term New Criticism as such was made current by the publication of John Crowe's Ransom's The New Criticism. The name of the book is The New Criticism, again, which was published in the year 1941. In this particular book, he reviewed the critical essays of I. Richards, T.S. Eliot and Ivor Winters. The term New Criticism came to be applied to a theory and practice that was prominent in American literary criticism until the late 1960s. The movement, of course, had its origins in T.S. Eliot's essays in The Sacred Wood, which was published in the year 1920, which John Crow Ransom taught to his students Alan Tate and Robert Penn Barron. And also I. Richards's Principles of Literary Criticism, published in the year 1924, and Practical Criticism, published in the year 1929. So T.S. Eliot's works and I. Richards' works could be considered as the origin of the movement of New Criticism. Now this particular theory, New Criticism, opposed the prevailing notions, the prevailing interest of scholars and critics on the biographical, the subjective, the aesthetic, impressionism, the socio-historical context of the author. And New Criticism as such insisted that the proper concern of literary criticism should not be with the extraneous factors, but with a detailed consideration of the text itself. Now, this shift in thought from the biographical, subjective, historical, contextual details onto the work could be, this particular shift in thought and tone in criticism can be noticed in the works of Cleon Brooks, Robert Penn Barron, William Empson, F.R. Lewis, Alan Tate, R.P. Blackmore, William K. Wimsatt and Monroe Beardsley. Now, we should of course not think that all these critics formed a particular group of their own and had the same philosophic notions. It's not like that. It is just that they shared many attitudes. They just shared many attitudes, but were of course different in their own ways. For example, if you're taking T.S. Eliot, T.S. Eliot's theological judgment was of course not shared by others. So all of them had their own paths, but they did share some of the attitudes, and all the critics could actually be seen differently. What brought all these people together is that they all of them opposed the system that was prevailing at that moment. All of them questioned the application of biology, psychology, economics and sociology to literary studies. They just wanted criticism to judge literature, and they attacked all sorts of extrinsic details, extrinsic criticism. Now, what is this biographical and historical and sociological criticism that they were talking against? In these types of criticism, in biographical or historical or sociological criticism, what happens is, instead of the primary text, instead of the text, the biographical and the historical context of the text becomes important. The biographical and historical context of the text were examined, and the primary text that we deal with was taken as a sole evidence for interpreting the history, interpreting the biography of the author. Now, author and history, for that matter, would be important to historians, not to critics. So this kind of criticism, the biographical kind or historical kind of criticism, does not provide us with an objective standard to analyze literature. That was why new critics as such were very much, or they opposed the prevailing standards of criticism. Now let's look at the basic tenets of new criticism. The first feature of new criticism is that new critics considered the poem as an autotelic entity, which is complete in itself, primarily, as Eliot puts it, primarily as poetry and not another thing. A poem should not mean but be. It should be considered as an autonomous entity, which is quite independent, which is quite self-sufficient, and nothing should divert the attention from the poem, not its origins or its destination, not the author or the readers. William K. Vimsatt and Monroe Beardsley proposes two fallacies that a critic encounters while analyzing a literary work. Now, these two fallacies are called intentional fallacy and affective fallacy. He talks about these two fallacies in his work, The Verbal Icon, which was published in the year 1954. Now, what is intentional fallacy? Intentional fallacy is the error of interpreting and evaluating a literary work by taking into consideration the intention of the author. It is an error of analyzing or interpreting the work taking into consideration the intention of the author. The author's intended aims and meanings in writing a literary work, whether the intentions are told to you by the author himself, or you deduce it from the knowledge that you have of the author and the opinions, of course, that you got from him, are very much irrelevant and sometimes harmful to the evaluation of the literary text, as the meaning of the text and the structure of the text, the value of the text is very much contained in the it is very much contained in the complex organic unity of the text itself. You need not go for what the author intended while writing this particular work, because the complexity of the text defines and determines the structure of the text, determines the meaning of the text. Now, the text itself is a freestanding entity, is an autonomous entity, and we should focus, critics should focus on the internal constitution and inherent values of the text. Now, if we go for the sort of extraneous details of the author, the historical details where we could place the text, what happens is it diverts our attention from the primary focus, which is the text. That is the first fallacy that Wimsatt and Beardsley is talking about. Now, the second fallacy is affective fallacy. Affective fallacy is again an error in evaluating a work, evaluating a poem by its emotional effects on the reader. Now, what is the emotional effect it produces in the reader? That is what affective fallacy is. That is an error when you interpret a work according to the effect that it has produced on the readers. What happens as a result is the criticism ends up in impressionism and relativism. So instead of describing the effects of a work on the reader, the focus should be on the features, on the devices which are used in the work, the form of the work, by which these effects, the aesthetic effects are produced. Now, the text obviously, because it is a self-contained entity, it provides us with all the evidences that we need. And you just analyze the formal devices, the paradox, the irony, the tension, the ambiguities which are there inside, the formal features which are there inside the poem, which bring about a complex but organic unity to the poem. So New Critics were so that is the first tenet of New Criticism. So the second tenet of New Criticism is New Critics consider literature as a special kind of language which is opposed to the language of science, to the language of practical and logical discourse. And in literature, we are to analyze the interactions of words, interactions of the figures of speech, the symbols in the work, in the poem. So the language of practical use or scientific language is denotative in nature. There is denotative in nature in the sense there is a one-to-one correspondence between words and the objects they stand for. Now, literary language is not like that. Literary language is not denotative in nature. Instead, it is connotative in nature. So, literary language is a special form of language in which there are special arrangement of words and lines that bring about the complexity, that bring about the complex organic unity, which in turn provides us with aesthetic pleasure. And for New Critics, you cannot separate a form from the content. It is the form which gives the poem its meaning. It is, for New Critics, it is about what is said and how it is said. Now, the next feature of New Criticism is that the meaning of the poem is very much embedded in the structure, in the unity of the poem, and the readers and the critics are not to separate the meaning and the structure, which of course Cleon Brooks calls the heresy of paraphrase. Heresy of paraphrase means the complexity of the poem, the complexity, the very complex nature of the poem cannot be explained by paraphrasing it or by translating it. See, to give you an example, you might be familiar with the guides that you see, especially the guide that I have seen. Usually when you go to bookstalls and all, you see kinds of guides and paraphrasical notes on what the text is, especially of Shakespeare. It's quite horrible when you see Shakespeare paraphrased, right? One line of Shakespeare is so loaded, is so complex that you cannot, it is a crime to paraphrase something, to put things in another words. So packed are each and every line of a poem, be it of Shakespeare or be it of any other writer for that matter. Each and every line would be so packed that it is really a crime that you commit once you begin to paraphrase or once you begin to translate any work. So the next tenet or the fourth tenet of New Criticism is that, as I told you before, a poem is considered as an organic unity which is very much complete in itself. And what are we to do with this organic unity? What are we to do with this particular poem? What are we to do? We are to dig the text and not outside the text. See, we are to go for close reading of the text and not to paraphrase the text. So it is explication the text. It is explicate the text. It is close reading of the text. It's like this, you know, it's like this. You just read, you just go for close reading, and you should not bother about what is happening outside, whatever it is. You should go for close reading of the text. And when you go for the close reading of the text by disregarding all the extrinsic details, you go for the close reading of the text and you understand the complex interrelationships, the ambiguities, the paradoxes, the irony, the tension, which contribute to the complexity and the organic unity of the poem. You should see what makes the poem a poem. You should see what gives the meaning to the poem. You should see how the meaning is being brought to the poem. So all these devices, the irony, the paradox, the ambiguity, all these devices help us. Of course, it brings about a complexity, but it also helps us to resolve the conflict, resolve the tension which is produced inside the poem. So it is these devices, it is these poetic devices which contribute to the harmony of the work. Say for example, I'll give you a very simple example. I mean, you should analyze a poem as you analyze a pudding for that matter, or if it is payasam for that matter. What happens is, when you drink payasam or when you just eat a pudding, what happens is, do you actually go for who made it? Do you ask the person who had brought it? Do you ask him or her, is it your mother who had made it? Is it your father who had made it? If it is your father, in what circumstances did he made it? In what room? I mean, whether he made it in kitchen or what? We are not bothered about all those things. You don't go for who made it. You don't go for at what historical juncture was that particular payasam or pudding made. You do not go for the circumstances that led to the making of it, whether it is his birthday or, I mean, wedding anniversary or whatever it is. You just drink it, right? The first thing that you do is you just drink it. And you just drink it and you just see whether the sugar, the salt, the spices, the ingredients, all these things add to the taste of the pudding or not. You see the complexity of the pudding and the resolution which is brought about the taste of the pudding. So you just see it, you just taste it. So likewise, in poem, you see the linguistic elements, you see the tension, you see the irony, you see the paradox, and the reconciliation of these diverse impulses, the equilibrium which is brought about the paradoxes, the equilibrium which is brought about by irony, by ambiguity, and by tension in the poem. So it's always, as I told you, it's always a close reading of the text. It is always intrinsic criticism, not extrinsic criticism, because the criticism is very much confined within the text, whereas extrinsic criticism goes outside the text. wander helter and skelter to get to the meaning. Now, to sum up these tenets, I would of course list here the what Cleon Brooks had said in his essay, the formalist critics, which you can of course read here. Cleon Brooks has of course summed up this in his essay, The Formalist Critics, which was first published in the Kenyon Review. You just can read it. Okay. Now that literary theory had developed a lot and new criticism had become somewhat outdated, in a sense, René Wellek in his The New Criticism, Pro and Contra, describes four charges which are leveled against new criticism. The first charge is its esoteric aestheticism, which shows no concern with the social function of literature and says that it's almost like the revival of the art for art's sake movement. The second charge against new criticism is that new critics are often called formalists as they lack social concerns, and it is unhistorical as it isolates the work from its origin and aims, which in order to make criticism scientific, more scientific in nature. And another criticism which is leveled is that this particular criticism, new criticism, is only useful as a pedagogical tool, which is useful at a very beginning level, at the level when students learn to read literary texts. Now you have these are the charges leveled by René Wellek in his work The New Criticism, Pro and Contra. You do have other rejections of new criticism coming from Jeffrey Hartman in his essay Beyond Formalism. You have criticisms, rejections from Chicago critics, myth criticism, Geneva School, structuralists, Russian formalists, and so on. In spite of all the charges that was leveled against new criticism by different critics, for that matter, what we should understand is that new criticism as a movement has dominated the critical discourse for almost four decades. And though many critics brand it as outdated, it is very much dated in the sense that some of the important concepts that new criticism talks about has been absorbed, has been taken in by all the theories today. See, evidences from the text is always foregrounded so as to validate interpretations, and the close reading that new criticism has taught us is even now practiced. We do close reading of the text all the time. It is always the text which comes first. The close reading is very much practiced as a pedagogical method in teaching and learning process. And new critics has also helped much in the advancement of literary criticism and understanding of the literary form. The complexity of the work, the organic unity of the work, the complexity which comes from the work is very important. And this is if you're taking deconstruction, we see that the complexity of the text is very important and very fundamental in deconstructive criticism. And we see that the assertion of new criticism could be seen in deconstructive criticism, whereas the rejection of new criticism could be seen in reader response theory. So for new criticism, we should end up by saying that, to wind up, I would like to say that for new criticism, form and content coexisted inseparably. They stand, both the form and the content stand for the organicity of the poem. They are concerned with new critics are concerned with the meaning of the poem, the worldview which is being conveyed in the poem. And they focus on the poem not as a mere process of communication, the poem is not merely an act of communication, but the poem is considered as an artifact, as an artifact with a shaping principle of organization. The close reading which new critics talk about, the close reading that new critics deal with, was never a sterile activity. It helps the critic to see the work as a totality, as a gestalt, as a whole. Thank you all.